Okay, we have the next speaker, Nikolai Kudasov from Annapolis University. Let's go.
Hello, everyone. So I'm here happy to present our work with my co-authors, Renata Shakirova, Igor Shalagin, and Karina Tsulibaeva on the free foil, an approach to generate efficient and scope-safe abstract syntax. And first of all, let me just thank the organizers for we're happy to be at this conference. And perhaps surprisingly for this small conference, they had a quite strong program committee, which we're happy to receive details and helpful comments from their viewers. So thanks to the organizers and to the viewers of the conference. So without further ado, let me talk about our work. So first of all, we're going to be talking about capture avoiding substitution. So capture avoiding substitution is a very old, very well-known problem. And it binds down to the situation where in presence of bound or local variables, substitution, so when we replace a variable, a local variable, with some other expression, this is not trivial in general. A very simple example in lambda calculus would be like this, where we have a function of two arguments. So we have here a function of two arguments x and y, which returns x, and this is applied to some other variable y. So this other variable y is different from this y, because this one is locally bound, and this one comes from some outer scope, so from outside. And by the rules of lambda calculus, when we apply this function, we need to then replace the variable x with y, but doing so naively is incorrect, because now we conflate the global y with the local y. So this is, of course, present and studied a lot in lambda calculus, but this is not just a theoretic issue. Capture avoiding substitution is very important and is used to implement a lot of things related to programming languages and formal systems, such as type elaboration and type checking, especially with dependent types, inlining and other hygienic transformations in compilers. For example, GHC, Glasgow Haskell compiler, uses that a lot. It's also used in hygienic macro expansion, for example, in Lean or in Lisps. It's also used in SMT solvers and theorem provers and some other formal systems. So, of course, this is not a new problem, and there's been a lot of solutions to deal with it. This is not a complete list, but these are just some of the relevant things. So, we focus in our work on safety, efficiency, and generality, or the ability to implement stuff in a general fashion. And so, of course, the naive solution is not safe, not efficient, and not general enough. And the first very widely known solution that improves upon that is De Bruyne indices. And I cite here the very first mention of that. But of course, there are a lot of variations which are offer more efficiency or more safety. For example, Bird and Patterson introduced a safe version of De Bruyne indices, which is unfortunately less efficient than the original ones. There's also the Rapier, which I'm going to talk about in a second. There are other interesting approaches like higher-order abstract syntax or parametric higher-order abstract syntax, which offers safety and efficiency by sort of cheating and deferring the handling of bound variables to the host language. But that's not what we're going to talk about today. Today, we are talking about free foil, and this is an approach that combines two previously existing approaches, which are relatively recent. The foil was introduced by a team of Google researchers that are developing the DEX programming language. And it sort of improves on the Rapier, and I will talk about that in a second. And free scope monads is something that I've been working on in the previous years, which combines safety and generality, but of lacks efficiency. So our goal is basically to combine the best things and ideally to have safe, efficient, and general solution for dealing with capture-avoiding substitutions. So the Rapier, I have to talk about the Rapier, is a technique that was introduced in 2002 by Simon Peyton-Jones and Simon Marlowe, and I believe it is still used in Glasgow Haskell compiler and in ACTA. And this is a technique to implement efficient inlining And in particular, it talks about efficient capture-avoiding substitution. It does not implement De Bruyne indices. It instead implements something called Barendrecht convention, which essentially means that the names are sufficiently unique, and you just don't have to. You just sometimes need to check things when you do substitution, but you keep the names unique. Try to keep the naming unique. Interestingly, the Rapier specifically does not rely on a global state, so it's amenable to parallelization, and it also relies on immutable or purely functional maps for efficient scope and substitution representation. Now, the foil, which is now introduced by the Google researchers, uses the same underlying representation as the Rapier, and what they did is they tried to use the Rapier to develop their DEX programming language. But they've failed to do this without bugs multiple times. And so at the end, they decided, okay, we have to just add safety on top of the Rapier so that we stop shooting ourselves in the foot. And they've relied on some relatively advanced, but relatively widely known in the Haskell community, at least, type system features like existential types and rank 2 polymorphism. To make a safe interface to the Rapier. So it has the same efficiency as the Rapier, but it is now safe to use on the user side. It involves more complicated types, but in the end, you do not get any performance penalties. So the foil, in brief, introduces scope-safe types and classes to ensure this type safety. So for example, name n is a type of an identifier that is valid in scope n. N here is a type variable, so it's tracked statically by the Haskell type checker, right? We use this type variables to make sure that we do not misuse names and do not accidentally use names from one scope in a different scope. Name binder NL is a type of an identifier that extends scope N to scope L, and then scope N is a set of identifiers in scope N, and there are constraints like DX that ensure that L contains distinct names and it indeed extends N. So to work safely under binders, the foil relies on rank 2 polymorphism. For example, here is a function with refreshed, and its type is as follows. It takes three arguments. It takes the current scope that we are in. It takes the name that we want to add in the scope. And then the idea is that sometimes we can do that safely when it does not conflict with the names in the current scope. But sometimes we need to refresh it so that we need to introduce a fresh name, change it, rename it, basically, to properly extend the scope. And so this with refreshed as its third argument takes basically a continuation, so a function that takes as input the updated name, which possibly has the same name as before, but maybe is refreshed, with a confirmation that this new binder does indeed extend scope O. And then if we can do something with that binder, well, we basically do it. And the use of the for all in the type of the third argument ensures that the user cannot in advance know what would be the new scope, how it will be exactly extended. So the user has to work agnostically of that, and that provides the necessary type safety to work under binders. So the user then can use the foil to construct scope-safe abstract syntax. For example, here's a definition of a syntax for lambda calculus. Without getting into much detail, I think the important thing is that in the lambda construction, we have two arguments, the name binder that extends the current scope N to L, and then the body of the lambda, which is now in the extended scope with the type parameter L. Now, for the foil to work properly and efficiently, the user also has to provide something that's called a sinkability proof, which is done as an instance of a type class. These are technicalities, but this is basically what convinces the foil that the expression that the user defined is safe to efficiently use in the in the functions like, so specifically this is about using an expression in a larger scope safely and efficiently. So this is something that the user has to provide. And of course, then the user can write this capture avoiding substitution. And this is the code. And again, I don't want to get into the details of the code itself. Just want to say that in this code, the types that the foil produces ensures that we do not forget to handle the scopes. We do not forget to refresh binders. We do not forget to extend scopes, extend substitutions, et cetera, et cetera. However, the problem with the foil, or at least one of the problems, is that the user still has to write all of this. So it has to write this substitution. It has to write the code on the previous slide. And of course, this is for lambda calculus. If you work with a real language, you have a lot more constructions that you have to deal with. So the foil is safe, but it does not provide any of the automation. So it does not provide capture avoiding substitution itself. It does not provide equivalence checks. And as we have been, as we have figured out, it is very non-trivial to actually implement efficiently. It does not provide any scope-safe abstract syntax for the object language by default. The user has to write it. It does not provide conversion functions or any automation for the conversion functions between the raw representation which is usually generated, for example, by parser generators, to the safe representation. So that also has to be written by the user. And the syncability proofs are relatively straightforward in most cases, and they should be. We should be able to derive them automatically. We don't have to delegate this proof on the user, but this is something that the foil does not provide. The foil also does not offer general support for patterns, although it can be relatively easily extended, and we do that in our work. And one metric that we can talk about is how many lines of Haskell code does it requires to implement a lambda pi interpreter, which is a slightly bigger language than lambda calculus itself. And it takes 251 lines of Haskell code to do that, which, considering that Haskell is a very dense language, is quite a lot. So now, the first thing that we can do is we can try to generate stuff to connect the scope-safe abstract syntax to the more naive or simple data types that Haskell programmers are very happy to write. And specifically, we wanted to connect it to parser generators like BNF converter that generate types from a grammar file. And our first idea was to extend the grammar with some scope annotations to generate scope-safe syntax. However, as it turned out later, we could just declare specific constraints on the types already in Haskell and not do anything in the BNF. And that is sufficient. So for example, here we have, again, a very simple definition of lambda calculus, but we specifically introduce the types for patterns and scoped expressions so that our metaprogramming approach can understand where which identifiers should be treated as binders and which identifiers are just part of the expression, and similarly for scopes. So what we did is we took Template Haskell, which is a metaprogramming library for Haskell, and we are able to generate scope-safe abstract syntax, conversion functions to and from raw representation, and syncability proofs, and this works very well with at least BNFC-generated types, even with the more general ones that it can generate. However, we do not generate substitution or alpha equivalence because even though it's technically possible, Template Haskell is sort of doesn't seem like a good tool for that. It's a little bit fragile in the long run, and we prefer avoid relying on it too much. And using Template Haskell, we now are down to 98 lines of code. How much time do I have? 3 minutes. Okay. Well, so the next step is merging the foil with the free scope monads. So to enable generic algorithms, we do that. I'm not going to get into the details, but the idea is that we separate the types for the recursive nature of the data structure and the binders from the syntactic nodes themselves. So here on this slide, this is the signature of the Lambda calculus, which basically says Lambda calculus is a language with variables and binders, and there are only two important constructions in that language. It's the application, which takes two terms, and Lambda abstraction, which just has a scoped body. And then we get everything from that almost for free. So FreeFoil now is able to generate capture avoiding substitution, alpha equivalence checks, abstract syntax a la carte, so we can actually have two different signatures and combine them into a larger language. And we can also theoretically implement higher order unification, which we did not do for the free FreeFoil, but it is implemented in the in the FreeScope Monads approach, which FreeFoil is based on. So this is like future work. Now, finally, we can take the benefit of the both approaches, template Haskell with metaprogramming and this generic programming with the FreeFoil. This was not in the paper that we at the time of publishing, but recently we have been able to improve and combine the two approaches to get template Haskell and FreeFoil so that we can get the entire implementation down to 77 lines of Haskell code. And some of these lines are just, well, asking the compiler to generate stuff for us. So we have also benchmarked our different implementations, and the results are can be found on GitHub. But our findings basically are as follows. The FoIL is faster than FreeFoil, and FreeFoil is faster than FreeScope Monads approach, which is the predecessor, which is fairly expected. We also tried strict and lazy implementations, but we have found that they win in strictness wins in some scenarios, but laziness wins in others. And also, we have discovered that the fastest implementations actually use an optimization already in the object language, which is called delayed substitutions. And this is something to note for future work. So the results are as follows. We have generalized the FoIL slightly by allowing it to support patterns. We have implemented template Haskell generators for the FoIL. We have introduced free FoIL representation, generic substitution for the free FoIL, performance benchmarks, and we have implemented Lambda calculus interpreter in different approaches. And additionally, we have template Haskell now for the free FoIL. We have generic alpha equivalence. We have generic conversion helpers for the free FoIL. And all of this works well with the parser generators like BNFC. And just to mention some future work, there's a lot of stuff to investigate, like generalized patterns for the free FoIL, generalized closure representation to enable even more efficient algorithms like with delayed substitution and normalization by evaluation. Generic high-order unification algorithms would be nice to have. We also might experiment with some variations of representation to offer better performance. It's also possible to simplify the interface, we think, with singleton scope types. So with singleton types have been introduced more than a decade ago, and we think it can be used. And finally, there is another approach to generic programming which might be able to reduce or even make it make the overhead zero for the free FoIL, and this is via GHC generics, and specifically we probably might need generic programming for all kinds by a recent work by Serrano, Mena, and Miraldo. So that is all that I have for you, and I'm not sure if there's time for questions, but I hope there is. Okay, sorry about that, and thank you for listening anyway.
We'll have questions maybe later under the video.
Okay, perfect.